Patrick?
Hi, Michelle. What's up?
I'm traveling to Dublin in May and have been learning about various places to visit. However, I'm getting confused by some of these reviews.
What do you mean? Could you explain more?
This one review talks about the Guinness Brewery. The text mentions a student, and I have no idea who that refers to. This other review is about the Halfpenny Bridge, and then also mentions the Liffey Bridge. Why is it suddenly mentioning another bridge?
The student in the first review is William Gossett, who was the head brewer of Guinness and a famous statistician. He could not publish papers with his surname, so he used the pseudonym Student. In the second review, Halfpenny Bridge and Liffey Bridge refer to the same bridge.
Thanks for letting me know. I wish there was some kind of software that could help me distinguish these words.
This problem of linking words that refer to each other is called coreference resolution. There are existing NLP models out there that can automatically determine which spans of text refer to the same entity. In fact, I have developed a model called iCoref that could help you with that.
Oh, thanks. Let me try using the model then.
There might be an issue when you use it. Like other coreference resolution models, iCoref was trained on OntoNotes, a dataset filled with news articles. It might not work for your setting unless you continue training the model on tourist reviews.
I don't think I have the time or resources to create such a dataset. I need to plan my trip to Dublin as soon as possible.
Maybe if there was a way to train the model on a small sample of reviews? I think that would still be helpful to adapt the model.
I wonder if I could use active learning for this problem. I can select data to label with the goal of reducing annotation time and cost. What if I apply active learning to adapt coreference resolution models?
Coreference resolution model is certainly a challenging problem, but nowadays, neural models can achieve high accuracy on commonly used datasets such as OntoNotes. Researchers have trained their models on OntoNotes and made them publicly available for others to use. However, these models may not immediately generalize to new domains. In this example, the span of the bonds no longer refers to municipal bonds. Instead, it links to chemical bonds in the science domain. Models that were originally trained on OntoNotes may not be accurate anymore for domains like scientific articles or tourist reviews. Patrick, from early in this video, has shown in his work that continued training the model on the target dataset is useful for domain transfer. However, they did not consider the time and cost of obtaining label data in the target domain. For practical purposes of coreference resolution, we would like methods that can easily transfer models without relying on an abundant supply of annotations. For example, given this review about the Guinness Brewery, which spans of text should we label? First, we can consider labeling spans that confuse the model's mention detector. In other words, the model does not know whether this particular span is an entity mention. For example, the word experience could be a verb or a noun depending on the context. Another confusing example would be time. Because of how this review is written, the word time may confuse the model as an entity mention. Second, we can consider labeling spans that confuse mention clustering. In the beginning of the video, I did not know the student referred to William Gossett. So, labeling the cluster of spans like the student and the brewery could help improve mention clustering. Third, we may want to consider labeling spans that confuse mention clustering conditioned on mention detection. In other words, there are spans that are clearly entity mentions but are confusing to link. This strategy will sample pronouns, for example, like the word you. Lastly, we want to label spans that challenge both mention detection and mention clustering. The span, a well-known method in statistical inference, is lengthy and may be hard for the model to detect as an entity mention in its entirety. It is also hard to link it to students' t-test if the model hasn't trained on similar data. In our experiments, we test our uncertainty sampling strategies and compare them against two random sampling baselines. One baseline is pure random sampling from all spans in the document. We imagine that this baseline will sample many spans that are not entity mentions and provide uninformative labels. Therefore, we have another sampling baseline where we only randomly sample from the pool of likely entity mentions. This baseline is much stronger and more comparable to our other strategies. For this video, we focus on transferring the model
from a source domain, OntoNotes, to a target domain, Preco, which is a large corpus of grade school text. One main difference is that OntoNotes does not annotate singletons, which are clusters with only one entity mentioned. So, the OntoNotes model may not be able to detect the singletons in Preco. We evaluate the models developed with each active learning strategy based on average F1 score on Preco. On each cycle, we sample 50 spans from a document of the Preco training dataset, use gold annotations to label them, and then train the OntoNotes model on these newly labeled spans. First, mention detection entropy shows about average F1 score of 0.73 by end of the simulation. Next, mention clustering entropy shows similar behavior. Then, conditional entropy shows a drop in accuracy. Accuracy jumps back up again with joint entropy. And then random sampling performs even worse than conditional entropy. Finally, sampling random entity mentions is stronger than pure random sampling, but still not as great as the other active learning strategies. Overall, we see high average F1 scores from mentioned detection entropy, mentioned cluster entropy, and joint entropy. As we have predicted, pure random sampling hurts them all the most. In the previous experiments, we limit span sampling to one document per active learning cycle. What happens if we want to sample spans across different document contexts rather than staying within one piece of text? For example, suppose that we only want to label 3 spans. If we choose to stay within the same document, then we may want to only label the student, the brewery, and experience from the first review. However, what if we could label coreference of 3 spans from 3 different documents? Then, by covering coreference in different contexts, we may be able to transfer the model to the target domain better. The caveat is that labeling 3 documents requires reading all of them. And with more reading, this might cause a slowdown in coreference labeling. To understand the effects of sampling from one document versus multiple documents, we simulate sampling 50 spans from all documents on each active learning cycle. We show a side-by-side comparison between the previous one document sampling simulation and the unconstrained sampling simulation. So first, for mention detection entropy, we see F1 score dropping as the cycles increase in the unconstrained sampling simulation. Next, for mention clustering entropy, we see similar degenerative behavior. For conditional entropy, the average F1 score for unconstrained starts to converge towards 0. We see degenerative behavior for joint entropy as well, and random sampling just does even worse. Surprisingly, sampling by random entity mentions does the best for unconstrained, but toward the end of the simulation, accuracy still is dropping off. In general, we notice that unconstrained setting is not only unrealistic for reading, but also unstable for model training. Upon further analysis, we notice that the model tends to predict singletons rather than cluster coreference spans. To prevent this from happening, we should limit labeling to a small set of documents. To understand how reading more documents affects labeling in humans for coreference, we hold a user study with 3 participants.
This is the interface for our user study that we've developed. So we show the users the document and the query span that they have to label the antecedent of as determined by the active learning strategy. So in this example, they have to label the antecedent of there. Now, they could first mark that there is not an entity mentioned or that it has no antecedent. But if they believe that it does have an antecedent, then they could go on to try to find it And as they're trying to find it, we will also provide potential candidates based on the likely entity mentions over here on the user interface to help guide the users. And in the end, they're going to find that there refers to the Enron employees. And they're going to keep on doing this for all the spans that were sampled by the active learning strategy. The code for this interface is open sourced and released along with the code for our active learning simulation.
We have users completing two 25-minute sessions. In the first session, they label multiple spans from each document for a limited number of documents. In the second session, they label only one span per document for a much larger set of documents. With this setup, they are required to read much more documents in the second session compared to the first. Here, the figure shows the number of spans labeled by the user as time progresses. The solid lines indicate progress in the few docs session, while the dashed lines indicate progress in the many docs session. Labeling throughput at least doubles in the few docs session compared to the many docs session. The results further motivate limiting coreference annotation to a few documents rather than sampling spans from across different documents. With these experiment results and conclusions, I now know how to use active learning to transfer Patrick's coreference resolution model. This will help me plan my trip to Dublin. For more information, please check out our ACL 2022 paper, Adapting Coreference Resolution Models Through Active Learning.